Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Senator Lugar, members of the committee for this important hearing. It's good to be back before you. Like past legal advisors, I'm honored to appear to explain the administration's legal position on the war powers. I've submitted detailed testimony, which you have before you, which reviews the brutality visited by Gaddafi on the people of Libya and the urgent but restrained steps this administration has taken to stop it as part of a supporting role within a NATO-led Security Council-authorized civilian protection mission that's limited with respect to design, exposure of U.S. troops, risk of escalation, and choice of military means. Today, let me make three points. First, this administration is acting lawfully, consistent with both the letter and spirit of the Constitution and the War Powers Resolution. Contrary to what some have claimed, we are not asserting sweeping constitutional power to bypass Congress. The President has never claimed the authority to take the nation to war without congressional authorization. He has never claimed authority to violate the War Powers Resolution or any other statute. He has not claimed the right to violate international law, to use force abroad when doing so would not serve important national interests, or to refuse to consult with Congress on important war powers issues. We recognize that Congress has powers to regulate and terminate uses of force, and that the War Powers Resolution plays an important role in promoting interbranch dialogue. Indeed, my testimony today continues that dialogue, which now includes more than 10 hearings, 30 briefings, and dozens of exchanges with Congress on these issues. From the start, we have sought to obey the law. I would not serve an administration that did not. The President reported to Congress, consistent with the War Powers Resolution, within 48 hours of commencing operations in Libya. He framed our military mission narrowly, directing, among other things, that no ground troops would be deployed, and that on April 4th, U.S. forces would transition responsibility to NATO command, shifting to a constrained and supporting role within a multinational civilian protection mission. And from the outset, we noted that the situation in Libya does not constitute a war, requiring specific congressional approval under the Declaration of War Clause of the Constitution. As my testimony notes on page 13, the President has constitutional authority, long recognized, to direct the use of force to serve important national interests in preserving regional stability and supporting the credibility and effectiveness of the UN Security Council. The nature, scope, and duration of the military operations he ordered here did not rise to the level of war for constitutional purposes. So my second point, we do not believe that the War Powers Resolution's 60-day automatic pullout provision applies to the limited Libya mission. As Senator Kerry quoted, absent express congressional authorization, the resolution directs the President to remove U.S. armed forces within 60 days from the date that hostilities or situations where imminent involvement in hostilities is clearly indicated. But as everyone recognizes, the legal trigger for the automatic pullout clock, hostilities, is an ambiguous term of art that is defined nowhere in the statute. The legislative history, which we cite, makes clear there was no agreed upon view of exactly what the term hostilities would encompass, nor has that standard ever been defined by any court or by Congress itself. From the start, legislators disagreed about the meaning of the term and the scope of the 60-day pullout rule, and whether a particular set of facts constitutes hostilities for purposes of the resolution has been determined less by a narrow parsing of dictionary definitions than by interbranch practice. The members of Congress who drafted the War Powers Resolution understood that this resolution is not like the Internal Revenue Code. Reading the War Powers Resolution should not be a mechanical exercise. The term hostilities was vague, but they declined to give it more concrete meaning, in part to avoid hampering future presidents by making the resolution a one-size-fits-all straitjacket that would operate mechanically without regard to the facts. As my testimony recounts, and as Senator Kerry has himself noted, there are various leaders of this Congress who have indicated that they do not believe that the U.S. military operations in Libya amount to the kind of hostilities envisioned by the 60-day pullout provision. We believe that view is correct and confirmed by historical practice. And the historical practice, which I summarize in my testimony, suggests that when U.S. forces engage in a limited military mission that involves limited exposure for U.S. troops and limited risk of serious escalation and employs limited military means, we are not in hostilities of the kind envisioned by the War Powers Resolution that was intended to trigger an automatic 60-day pullout. Let me say just a word about each of these four limitations. First, the nature of the mission is unusually limited. By presidential design, U.S. forces are playing a constrained and supporting role in a NATO-led multinational civilian protection mission charged with enforcing a Security Council resolution. This circumstance is virtually unique, not found in any of the recent historic situations in which the hostility questions has been debated, from the Iranian hostages crisis to El Salvador to Lebanon to Grenada to the fighting with Iran in the Persian Gulf or to the use of ground troops in Somalia. Second, the exposure of our armed forces is limited. From the transition date of March 31st forward, there have been no U.S. casualties, no threat of significant U.S. casualties, no active exchanges of fire with hostile forces, no significant armed confrontation or sustained confrontation of any kind with hostile forces. And as my testimony describes on page 9, past administrations have not found the 60-day rule to apply even in situations where far more significant fighting plainly did occur, such as in Lebanon and Grenada in 1983 and Somalia in 1993. Third, the risk of escalation here is limited. In contrast to the UN-authorized Desert Storm operation, which presented over 400,000 troops, the same order of magnitude as Vietnam at its peak, Libya has not involved any significant chance of escalation into a full-fledged conflict characterized by a large U.S. ground presence, major casualties, sustained active combat, or an expanding geographic scope. In this respect, Libya contrasts with other recent cases, Lebanon, Central America, Somalia, the Persian Gulf tanker controversy, discussed on page 10 of my testimony, where past administrations declined to find hostilities under the War Powers Resolution, even though U.S. armed forces were repeatedly engaged by other sides' forces and sustained significant casualties. And fourth and finally, Senators, we are using limited military means, not the kind of full military engagements with which the War Powers Resolution is primarily concerned. And there I quote from a statement by my predecessor, the legal advisor of 1975, in response to a request from the Congress about an incident during the Ford administration. The violence U.S. armed forces are directly inflicting or facilitating after the handoff to NATO has been modest in terms of its frequency, intensity, and severity. The air-to-ground strikes conducted by the U.S. are a far cry from the extensive aerial strike operations led by U.S. armed forces in Kosovo in 1999, or the NATO operations in Balkans in the 1990s, to which the U.S. forces contributed the vast majority of aircraft and airstrike sorties. To be specific, the bulk of U.S. contributions has been providing intelligence capabilities and refueling assets to the NATO effort. A very significant majority of the overall sorties, 75%, are being flown by our coalition partners. The overwhelming majority of strike sorties, 90%, are being flown by our partners. American strikes have been limited on an as-needed basis to the suppression of enemy air defenses to enforce the no-fly zone, and limited strikes by Predator unmanned aerial vehicles against discrete targets to support the civilian protection mission. By our best estimate, Senators, since the handoff to NATO, the total number of U.S. munitions dropped in Libya has been less than 1% of those dropped in Kosovo. Now, we acknowledge that had any of these elements been absent in Libya or present in different degrees, you could draw a different legal conclusion. But it was this unusual confluence of these four limitations, an operation that is limited in mission, limited in exposure, limited in risk of escalation, and limited in choice of military means, that led the president to conclude that the Libya operation did not fall under the automatic 60-day pullout rule. As Chairman Kerry suggested, we are far from the core case that most members of Congress had in mind when they passed the resolution in 1973. They were concerned there about no more Vietnams. But given the limited military means, risk of escalation, exchanges of fire, and U.S. casualties, we do not believe that the 1973 Congress intended that its resolution should be construed so rigidly to stop the president from directing supporting action in a NATO-led Security Council-authorized operation with international approval at the express request of NATO, the Arab League, the Gulf Cooperation Council, and Libya's own Transitional National Council for the narrow but urgent purpose of preventing the slaughter of innocent civilians in Libya. Third and finally, Senators, we fully recognize reasonable minds may read the resolution differently. That would not be a surprise, they have since their inceptions. Scholars have spent their entire careers debating these issues. These questions of interpretation are matters of important public debate. Reasonable minds can certainly differ. And we acknowledge that there were perhaps steps we should have taken or could have taken to foster better communication on these very difficult legal questions. But none of us believes that the best way forward now is for Gaddafi to prevail and to resume his attacks on his own people. With the United States now to drop out of this collective civilian protection mission or to sharply curtail its contributions would not only compromise our international relationships and destabilize the region, but would undo NATO's progress by permitting Gaddafi to return to brutal attacks on the very civilians whom our intervention has protected. However we may construe the War Powers Resolution, we can all agree it would only serve Gaddafi's interest for the U.S. to withdraw from this NATO operation before it's finished. And so the urgent question before you is not one of law, but of policy. Will Congress provide its support for NATO's mission in Libya at this pivotal juncture, ensuring that Gaddafi does not regain the upper hand against the people of Libya? And so in closing, I ask that you take quick and decisive action to approve Senate Joint Resolution 20, the bipartisan resolution introduced by Senators Kerry, McCain, Durbin, Cardin, and seven others of your colleagues to provide congressional authorization for continued operations in Libya to enforce the purposes of Security Council Resolution 1973. Only by so doing can this body affirm that the United States government is united in its support of the NATO alliance and the aspirations of the Libyan people. Thank you, Senator, and I look forward to answering your questions.